morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Radek ŠPICAR. I'm the executive director of Aspen Institute Prague, which is one of the two institutions co-organizing our today's panel. The other one is Prague 20, headed and founded by Vladimír DLOUHÝ. First of all, I would like to welcome you all and thank you all for accepting our invitation. It's great to see that Euro is of such great interest to so many of you, despite the fact that Czech Republic is still not a member of the Eurozone. It is a hot topic, obviously, and as we all know, opinions differ when it comes to pros and cons of the common European currency, and that's why we decided to actually invite a third party, because there are people who think Euro is a blessing in the Czech Republic, but at the same time there's a group of people thinking that it's rather a curse. So we thought it would be a good idea to invite a third party which will share with us its opinion concerning the current situation and the future of Euro. And I think that we really did a good job, because if you look at the individuals sitting on the panel, you can hardly imagine better insiders and movers and shakers when it comes to Euro. So without further ado, I would like to thank you again for coming, and I would like to pass the floor to the founder of Prague 20, whose idea it was to organize this panel and who will be acting as a moderator of today's discussion, Mr. Vladimír DLOUHÝ. Thanks for coming and enjoy the debate.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And thank you, Radek, for a very nice introduction. It is my pleasure, after a relatively long break, which nobody else than myself is entirely responsible for, that long break. So after a long break, allow me to welcome you at another Prague 20 seminar. And as Radek ŠPICAR has already mentioned, we are very glad and pleased that Aspen Institute Prague decided to support our activities this year. And I dare to say that we might found a cooperation in the more future as well. We are thanking to Aspen Institute Prague for providing us the support. Without that support, probably we wouldn't be able to organize the meeting today. It is not only the long break between this meeting and our last meeting, but we are also in the other place. Normally we are just opposite the square, but there is a graduation ceremony for the students, and that's something which I'm afraid that it's even more important than Euro. The title we have chosen today, Euro, the past and the future, is not about the problems of common currency only. It is about the future of the European integration, about the future of what is called the European dream or European project. And I'm indeed extremely proud having such excellent speakers to the topics here today. Let me start with a bit provocative statement, but not to provoke, but to rather stimulate the discussion. I personally, but a view of one single economist is not important. I personally believe, and I have always believed, that Euro was a premature project and should not have been introduced back in 1999 and changing the coins and banknotes in 2010. I also believe that albeit Euro was not a primary cause of the present economic maladies in many countries on our continent, it has contributed to the depth and length of the present recession. Low interest rates allowed for the capital flows to the periphery, financing profligacy, asset bubbles, unjustified wage increases, and leading to the huge gap in competitiveness. I also personally believe that alignment and competitiveness differences is a primary task for the Eurozone policymakers today. This alignment can't be achieved via internal depreciations due to the political infeasibility. Nobody can imagine a further drop of wages and prices in Greece or elsewhere in the periphery. And the only way I see is to inflate northern economies through stronger economic growth and wage and price increases there. To this end, capital needs to flow from south to the north. Today, this is true for the private capital, but thanks to ECB OMT policy, we see public capital still flowing in the opposite direction to the south, as witnessed by present target two balances. The whatever it takes statement of ECB President Draghi last summer definitely helped to placate the markets that time and probably was very important. But again, and this is my own personal view only, its continuation, I believe, is controversial. But this, in a very nutshell presentation of one possible view of the present euro crisis, is only, as I said, a view of one single economist. And there is a whole plethora of interpretations and explanations. And also, I'd like to be well understood. I very highly appreciate the noble achievements of post-war economic integration. I want to see Europe strong, competitive, and with growing living standards. Euro is a reality, and it is in the Czech economy, and I would say the whole Czech society interest, to see eurozone stabilized. We, like everybody else in Europe, complain on many European shortcomings, from red tape to excessive or ill-conceived regulation. But on the European scene, we should not be distinguished. We should not distinguish ourselves as Czechs, as Czech Republic, by sarcastic criticism only. We should actively cooperate in all areas where we believe it is useful and where we can provide value added. And as a matter of fact, this is exactly happening. Maybe it's not to be seen so much, but it is happening, be it on the level of the state administration, be it on the level of central bank and other bodies. But we should also closely follow how eurozone, after achieving short-term stabilization, and let me repeat, I strongly believe that it is in our interest to see eurozone stabilized, that we should also closely follow how eurozone intends to proceed in strengthening institutional and political framework, not only for more efficient performance of common currency, but for ultimate goal of whole integration process, well-being of the European citizens, and place in today's world that Europe deserves given its history, culture, and entrepreneurial spirit. Here some of us are reserved, not to say skeptical, but the only way forward is to listen to each other. And that brings me to our first speaker. I'm extremely pleased that President Trichet has accepted the invitation of Prague 20 and Aspen Institute to come to speak. Very few people know what is the original education of President Trichet. He's a minor. He studied, I have it something here, L'École Nationale Supérieure des Mines de Nancy. But he also graduated from the two-star French University Sciences Po and École Nationale d'Administration. Jean-Claude served in the offices of President Valéry Giscard d'Estaing and also as the chef de cabinet of Edouard Balladur when he was Minister of Finance. Between 1997 and 1993, he was a treasury director or director at the French Treasury. And since 1993, he has become to be a governor of the Banque de France. And since November 2003, as we all already remember, he succeeded Wim Duisenberg and he became to be the president of the European Central Bank. And he navigated Europe's Central Bank through really a very stormy waters. After leaving the position of the ECB president, being succeeded by Mario Draghi, President Trichet is member of the board of EADC. He is also the chairman of Bruegel. And again, I'm very glad that Prague 20, after Mario Monti and Leszek Balcerovic, has another chairman of Bruegel speaking to us. And among other things, Jean-Claude is the chairman of the European leg of the Trilateral Commission, where I have a pleasure to be his vice chairman. Jean-Claude, thank you very much for accepting our invitation, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much indeed for your invitation, Vladimir. As you know, it's a great pleasure for me to work very closely with you in this position of having the responsibility together of the chair of the trilateral commission. I have also to say that to be here with Marek and Zdeněk is absolutely extraordinary. I have the sentiment that we are back to the period where we were working together extremely closely, and it's again a great, great pleasure for me. I am impressed by the audience, and I know that I am in a country which is discussing a lot, which has a dedication for weighing the pros and cons, the positives and the negatives. And I know also that the rule of the game is that you have to respond to a lot of very incisive and I would say as direct as possible questions. So I will try to stick to the main points of my message today. I heard what Vladimír said a moment ago on the timing. Timing, not necessarily the best one. It reminds me the story of the two British businessmen that were in Scotland in a very remote area. So they want to be aware of what's going on in the world, financial affairs. And so they go in a small shop selling papers, and they say, well, madam, could you give us the Financial Times? And the lady curiously says, do you want today Financial Times, gentlemen, or yesterday Financial Times? And they respond, well, today Financial Times is perfectly okay. And she says, well, if you want today Financial Times, why don't you come back tomorrow? So timing is, of course, always of the essence. Let me take my first point. I will have the nature of the crisis. I will have a comment on the three episodes that I see in the present crisis that we are experiencing at a global level. And then I will try to respond to the question, why is it that the Europeans have been and are still at the epicenter of the third episode of the crisis? And then I will conclude on the, I would say, repair of the weaknesses that explain that we were the epicenter and we are the epicenter of the crisis. For me, the nature of the crisis is that it is a crisis of the advanced economy. So, of course, we concentrate on Europe, even on Euro, but we have to have the big perspective. As you know, the crisis started in the United States of America. It was the worst financial crisis since World War II. Could have been the worst financial crisis since World War I, had we not reacted, we central bankers and governments, very boldly and swiftly. The amplitude of what has been done by the central bank in the heat of the crisis and what has been done by the government is currently underestimated, particularly what has been done by government. We avoided a Great Depression in embarking on extraordinarily bold measures and extraordinarily demanding measure in terms of involvement of the taxpayer. The crisis of the advanced economy, which is a global crisis, in my own reading, had three episodes. A first episode from the subprime crisis up to Lehman Brothers, say mid-07, mid-September 08. During that period of time, we had financial turbulences, a number of major difficulties that appeared on the markets. The first intervention of the European Central Bank on the non-conventional mode, the 9th of August 2007, with illimited supply of liquidity at fixed rate. And you might remember we were asked 95 billion euros, which was an enormous amount of liquidity. It was the start for the central banks and the money market that we are directly in contact with. It was the start of these financial turbulences. Went up to Lehman Brothers. Lehman Brothers is the start of the second episode where we had an immediate and grave threat of collapse of the financial system of the advanced economy, not of the emerging economy, of the advanced economy. This called for the reaction I mentioned, and the very bold and swift reaction, and then we went up to end of 09. End of 09, we could see that we had avoided the Great Depression, and that we were in a situation where it was clear that the derivatives of the real economy were going better. And so we could see that we had avoided the main danger. We had, of course, the sad experience of a great recession, not a great depression, but a great recession. And we were rebounding, I would say, slowly. Then started the third episode of the crisis. Instead of concentrating on the private sector signature, the investors and savers of the world concentrated on the public signature, on the treasuries themselves, on the fiscal position. And this is still the episode where that we are experiencing. It's not only a European problem. You know that in the United States of America, the fiscal policy is the major issue strategically from the fiscal and economic standpoint. In the UK, you can see to which extent, of course, the new government took decisions that were extremely bold from the standpoint of the fiscal policy and are disputed, by the way. And in Japan, everybody knows that Japan has also an enormous problem of debt outstanding. But what characterizes the third episode is that the epicenter of the crisis is in Europe and is more particularly in the euro area. The first episode had an epicenter in the US, it was the subprime. The second episode had an epicenter in the US, it was Lehman Brothers, after Burston, Freddie Mac, Fannie Mae, and before, if I may, AIG and other institutions, you name it. It was a global crisis, of course, epicenter in the US. The epicenter crossed the Atlantic at the end of 09, beginning of 10. And the best summing up I have is that when Ben Bernanke, with whom we had been, of course, in permanent contact during all time, particularly in the crisis, pointed his finger on me, saying, now, Jean-Claude, it's your turn. And it was really, I would say, summing up the fact that the epicenter had crossed the Atlantic, which I felt, by the way, quite heavily, of course. Now, question, why is it that amongst the advanced economy, with a crisis which is the crisis for the advanced economy in general, we were the epicenter, we are the epicenter? And I see very rapidly six reasons. I will only mention the reasons, of course, and I know that in the question, I'm sure that I will have some questions on those reasons. First reason, not that, Vladimir, in my opinion, we started too early the euro. First reason, we did not respect the framework that we had, namely the Stability and Growth Pact. I myself and all my colleagues in the euro area, we had said, we have no political federation, we have no federal budget, we have a single currency. The quid pro quo is that we must have a very solid framework for fiscal policy. It is not a sufficient condition for everything to go very well, but it's certainly a necessary condition. This was challenged. This was challenged, I have to say, sadly, by the major countries in Europe, particularly in 2003 and 2004, by France, my own country, by Germany, and by Italy. Only to mention those countries, which were adamant to say we don't need such a tight jacket. They were, it's not to excuse them, because I think that it's very difficult to forgive that. But nevertheless, I have to say that very curiously, the, I would say, majority of the economists the world over were indeed saying, you have a tight jacket, you should not have a tight jacket, you need breathing space, why do you have this Stability and Growth Pact? So the major countries in Europe were not respecting the pact, but more or less in line with a benign neglect that was the overwhelming position throughout the international community, which, by the way, was incredibly naive in thinking that we wouldn't have in the future cycle, that there was no need for caring for the signature of the public sector and of the treasuries. Even the IMF was called to dismantle its lending wing. This was the message of the international community in the years 03, 04, 05. So first reason, clear enough. Second reason, we didn't have at the time of the setting up of the euro monitoring of the competitive indicators. Since 05, I have to say that my colleagues in the governing council of the ECB, and maybe I can say also in the general council of the ECB, we are thinking that monitoring the evolution of unit labor cost and of competitive indicators and of external imbalances was something which was very important. I myself circulated every month the evolution of the unit labor cost and also the evolution of a number of nominal indicators, like simply the wages and salaries in the public sector, which were decided by the ministers of finance themselves. Enormous differences were observed in the in between the various countries, but that did not was considered at the time as something which was dangerous. I don't insist on that, but this is the second very, very important weakness. As important in a single currency area, as important as the fiscal policy monitoring, is the competitive indicators monitoring and excessive imbalances monitoring. Third reason, we didn't have a banking union, and in the crisis, the correlation between the creditworthiness of the countries and the creditworthiness of the banks appeared to be absolutely decisive in all advanced economies. But inside the euro area, it contributed to stretch even more the euro area, because you had a virtuous circle in the countries whose signature was very solid, and a vicious circle in the countries whose signature was very weak. And it created, of course, extreme tensions. I mentioned this. I know that Marek will elaborate much more on that. And then we had a total absence, and this is my fourth reason, my fourth weakness of the euro area, explaining why we are the epicenter of the crisis. We didn't have ex ante tool to cope with extraordinary circumstances. It was very easy in the United States of America to say, well, we mobilize immediately the federal institution and we engage in the TARP program, or we engage in any program that can be decided at the center. In the case of the European, we had to invent that. And it needed a treaty to invent the European stability mechanism. So you see to which extent, of course, it was difficult to foresee ex ante that we would have to cope with the worst crisis since World War II, but the fact is that we didn't have the tool immediately available. And this is the fourth reason. We have two more reasons that I mentioned, because I trust that they are very important, and they are very important for the 17, or tomorrow for the 18, but also for the 27. And for Zdeněk and Marek, also very important. At the level of the 27, we should achieve the single market, which we did not achieve. It's a problem for European Union as a whole, and it's a problem particularly for the euro area, because we need in the euro area a very flexible, achieved single market. And we didn't do the job at the level of the 27, and certainly not at the level of the 17, in the structural reform area. The famous Lisbon agenda, the famous 2020 now, are also issues that are very important and managed at the level of the 27, but particularly important for the 17, because again, the 17 need in a single currency a very flexible single market with a single currency. So now I have listed six reasons. Where do we stand? We have reinforced the Stability and Growth Pact considerably. We have agreed upon a fiscal compact, which gives even more clout legally to the Stability and Growth Pact. We have introduced a new pillar, which is called in the jargon of Europe macroeconomic imbalance procedure, MIP. Now, you have to retain that SGP, MIP are the two pillars of the European governance, and the MIP, the monitoring of the competitive indicators and the monitoring of the imbalances, including external imbalances, is extraordinarily important as the SGP. And then we have banking union in progress, and this is extremely important also. And then we have, of course, the new tools, that is the European Stability Mechanism. And we have, in principle, an agreement to go actively in the direction of achieving the single market and achieving the structural reform. I say we have in principle because we had that in principle since a long period of time. And if there is a message certainly coming from the observers and from me, if I may, is that this is extraordinarily important to be sure that we do all the job that is necessary. Now, will it suffice? What is absolutely clear is that all what has been decided has to be implemented in a very forceful manner, that the banking union has to be achieved, not only with a single supervisory mechanism, but also with a single resolution authority, and that is extremely important. It is the fact that we have decided all that explains, in my opinion, why the tail risk of a dismantling of the euro area has been considerably alleviated. This is one of the four reasons I see for that, if I may. First reason, a lot of improvement in the governance of the euro area has been decided, and this was unthinkable before the crisis. Second reason, we have an adjustment which is proceeding and is not really visible. But if I take the five countries that have been under stress during the crisis, I would say Ireland, Greece, Portugal, Italy, Spain, they had a consolidated current account deficit of 8% of the GDP in 2008-09. They have now, over the last 12 months, probably 1% of the current account deficit. So it's a considerable improvement, which is visible, of course, from those observers, investors, and savers that look very carefully at what's going on in Europe. Second reason. Third reason, and it's very important too, all countries decided that they would like to stay in the euro area, or that they would like to have all countries staying in the euro area. From that standpoint, a number of decisions have been taken by a number of parliament, including in Germany, and I think that the overwhelming majority in the Bundestag to say, well, we agree on helping countries staying with an orderly adjustment in the euro area, particularly Greece, was something which was extremely important because signaling determination, a strategic determination of the European. Again, it's not only the Bundestag, all other parliament did the same, but it was particularly visible in that case. And the last explanation I have, the fourth, is that the central bank was credible in saying, as far as we are concerned, and provided there is the appropriate conditionality, and provided there is the appropriate commitment of the governments, individually for those who have problems, and collectively for the euro area as a whole, we can step in because it's in line with our monetary policy responsibility to be sure that the monetary policy transmission channel are functioning. So I let you there. I would only, as a conclusion, say that we have to go even further, in my opinion. We improved a lot the overall governance of Europe. In improving this governance considerably, with, I have to say, also two new treaties during that period of crisis, we engage considerably in the direction of political union because, you know, the budget is very political. The macro policy are very political. And that we need now is to go further in the direction of a democratically accountable union. And that's the reason why I trust it's time certainly to reflect on what will be the future step, which will probably call for, I would say, a democratically accountable, which clearly says that the European Parliament has to play, and perhaps national parliaments together, have to play a more important role. Because again, we went very far in the direction of the political union, but the democratic accountability is still to be there. And of course, democratic accountability is absolutely decisive to give authority to the economic and fiscal union, which is in the making. But as you know, I am confident in Europe. I think we have good reason to be confident. I also want only, in conclusion, to mention the fact that, as you could see during all that period, the euro as a currency has delivered what it was asked to deliver. Stability, no deflation, no inflationary risk materializing, both protected by, I would say, a solid anchoring of the price stability at a level which we had given ex ante, less than 2, very close to 2. And that being said, a currency which, during the worst crisis since World War II, remained constantly credible. So that when you hear the euro will collapse and so forth, it's not true. It's not true. You look at the facts and the figures. What is true is the euro area governance, fiscal and economic governance, was very poor and had to be considerably improved. That is true. And that is, of course, the major conclusion that we can draw from the crisis. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Jean-Claude. Definitely, there might be differences of opinion, but I would like to make one personal comment which leads to the high appreciation of your step and the institution you were heading. And that comes me to your first point, description of the three periods of the upcoming crisis. In July 2007, I was on holiday in Madeira. Imagine the happy morning, fat, self-confident Goldman Sachs guy lying at the shore of the sea with my wife sipping morning coffee and reading Financial Times, today's Financial Times. And I learned suddenly there is a crisis. What was the German bank, AKW or something like that, or which was the first bank? It was not an American. It was the first bank which went bust was German. And something started lying by the sea, work in my brain. And in the next Financial Times, next morning, I learned that it was ECB who immediately started to react, who immediately understood the danger. And you called, if I'm not mistaken, the board, because it was in the height of the summer, by teleconference. Well, you remember better than I know. And it was the ECB who at that time acted extremely strongly, extremely timely, and extremely well. And I, disregarding all differences in opinions, what has been said here, I believe that this is something what was a very proper step that time. Ladies and gentlemen, let me move to another speaker, Marek Belka. Marek Belka is the Polish professor of economics who studied at the University of Lodz and then had different scholarship at the Columbia University, University of Chicago, and London School of Economics. He became an economics professor in Lodz in 1994. He served as the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance from 1997 to 2002 and then 2001 and 2002. Then he served as the advisor to Prime Minister of Albania and also as the advisor to JP Morgan for Central and Eastern Europe for a short period. And he was designated by President Kwaśniewski to become a prime minister. And if I remember it correctly, there was some kind of two-step procedure, but finally you were approved by the same in June in 2004, and you served as the Polish Prime Minister till the next election. I believe this was a very difficult period, and your government managed to stabilize the situation. Later, Marek Belka served as the director of the IMF European Department in Washington, and in May 2010, Marek Belka was nominated as the president of National Bank of Poland, to which he is today. And again, one personal opinion, I met Marek many, many times, but probably the most bizarre and also interesting meeting is that we met in Baghdad a couple of months after toppling Saddam Hussein in September 2003, and Marek Belka was an important part of the interim administration in that period in Iraq. Maybe today it does not seem to be a big distinction, but I would like to appreciate two things. I spent only 2 days there, and the work that Marek was doing was excellent. And second, it also says something about personal courage of Marek Belka. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome with my friend, the governor of National Bank of Poland.
Well, thank you, Vlado, for inviting me to this very prominent panel. I will say something which is complementary to what Jean-Claude had to say, and mostly where I feel at home is to give the perspective of a non-Eurozone country on most topical issues of today, which is the banking union. But mostly it will be Polish perspective, because when I reflected on the differences between such non-Eurozone countries as, say, UK, Sweden, Czech Republic, and Poland, there are very few similarities and very different, very, very big differences. Vlado was caught by surprise in Madeira. I remember just 1 week before the fall of Lehman Brothers, the Polish Prime Minister proudly announced that Poland is going to join the euro in 2011 or 12, at last. Well, he must have been caught by surprise too. The topic of my talk that I announced to the organizers was sort of remarks from the periphery, and this does not sound to be overly provocative for you, but if I said this in Poland, this is clearly a provocation. Because one thing that we hate to be is in the periphery. I mean, you don't understand this because you have never been in the periphery. We have always been in the periphery. And that is a problem for us, to avoid being in the periphery. So when we look at the euro, when we look at the banking union, which I'm going to concentrate in this talk, the political consideration that is always present in the debates in Poland is geopolitical. How to avoid being in the periphery, not in the inner circle. And we see that the European integration is now clearly going into two-speed or multi-speed model, and of course we don't like it. I add that if I have to choose between Europe of many speeds and Europe without any speed, then I choose the first. So I'd rather have a Europe and the European economy, European integration of many speeds and alive and kicking and being attractive to the whole world, rather than being stagnant. So we are very much keeping fingers crossed for the success of this reconstruction of the European integration, because this is more than just a reconstruction of the eurozone or construction of institutional foundation for euro, because of larger good. We believe that if things go wrong, the whole European project may go wrong. The biggest achievement of Europe, which is a common market, not only for goods, but increasingly for services, people, capital, may become fractured. So now, let me turn to the main issue that I want to elaborate on is the banking union. The banking union, I'm not going to repeat what you probably all know, how important it is and how indispensable it is in view of euro on one hand and very deep financial integration of the continent on the other. You cannot have banking union. If only for the following reason that I think is not mentioned too frequently. Once we in Europe decided for financial integration, buttressed by euro, European banks forgot that they had a country of origin. They decided, okay, our homeland is Europe. We are bound to be pan-European, some of them actively trying to become pan-European, very few succeeding, but still, it's like in the US, no American bank, although they should, treat an individual state as its home. It's American economy that you compare the size of banks and the banking sector with. The same idea, the same concept developed in the European banking sector. The banks thought and had reasons to believe that their homeland is Europe or euro as the currency, which proved to be wrong for many. So now we have to make up for deficiencies, and banking union is the obvious solution to amend, to repair this sort of imbalance between the full integration, full financial integration, purported at least, and still national fragmentation of the banking sector and, well, the banking sector. So now, what is the Polish approach to the banking union? Well, there are two reasons we should be absolutely enthusiastic about the banking union. And it's on top of the fact that banking union is indispensable for the euro survival, for the euro stabilization. It's one that 65% of the Polish banking sector is dominated by foreign, mostly European financial groups, which means that if the banking union comes into being, well, those banks will be indirectly, at least, in a banking union anywhere. So we should be enthusiastic about Polish participation in a banking union. And the second thing is that Poland is, contrary to the Czech Republic, a structural importer of capital. And we are vitally interested in capital flows to be smooth, to be efficient, and inexpensive. So there are good reasons for Poles to be, and for Polish elites, for Polish economic community, banking community, to be fully behind the idea of banking union and Polish membership in the banking union. Well, but we are not so enthusiastic, in fact. So the question is why? What are the awkward questions that we are asking others and asking ourselves mainly. Well, maybe first, we don't see that enthusiasm in Europe, generally. I mean, this is so much of a difficulty to build up the banking union that questions arise within the Eurozone countries, within the Eurozone countries' leaders. It's about the burden sharing, in fact. It's the division of competences between the center and the national authorities, timeline, coverage, all kinds of problems. And of course, I mean, this is understandable. It's such a difficult project that obviously, even if people think and are deeply convinced it is indispensable, then political interests kick in, and we are sort of navigating from one election date to another election date, and look for windows of opportunity for the leaders to agree on further steps. But the questions that we are asking ourselves are many, but let me just give you the flavor of those questions and some examples. Well, when we think of banking union, we think mostly of the SSM, the single supervision mechanism or supervisory mechanism, and single resolution mechanism or authority, whatever. I mean, these are the two main pillars, with deposit insurance being probably, I don't have a view whether this is correct or not, but it is sort of in the second priority or so. At least in the timeline, it's a little bit behind. Well, then, the question that we ask ourselves is, shall we be better off in the SSM and the SRM, single resolution mechanism, with our banks pooled into the whole European pot, because our banks are so different from what has grown out of typical big European banks? Polish banks, as the Czech banks, are small, traditional, with a very conservative risk profile of their assets. You can say, luckily, backward banks. I mean, this is probably something that the world would like to have worldwide. Banking systems like we have, we Czechs, we Poles. Well, then these banks will be treated as parts of big financial groups, financial European groups, which are different, which are very big, which are very complex, which have developed so much that other parts of financial system remains underdeveloped in Europe, say compared to the US. And I'm disregarding the historical reasons for this. So, will the banks, the Polish banks, or the Polish subsidiaries and Polish branches of foreign banks be treated properly in time of crisis, especially? Well, this is a legitimate question. Well, so far we have been very happy with the with foreign investors in the banking sector. They have behaved like very good sort of corporate citizens. However, we have some problems. One problem is that a number of those banks are in precarious position. For this, okay, I can use the name because it's gone already. Allied Irish Bank, once a champion of dynamism in the banking sector, is on a drip feeding. I will stop short, but there are some other examples of banks that are in poor shape. And we suddenly find ourselves in Poland in a situation where subsidiaries of those banks are for sale. Nothing wrong, but brings instability. Well, some of the great banks we have in Poland present come from the countries which are not in so great a shape. And here I will not mention the names of those countries. And also, we have the experience of exuberant growth, of the pre-crisis exuberant growth, which in Poland manifested itself in one form only, which is the wave of foreign exchange denominated mortgage loans. You know about Hungary, what kind of a challenge did it pose to the government, to the whole economy? We were a little bit luckier, maybe a little bit smarter, but still, the problem exists and is like a memento of what may go wrong if you don't have a very strict supervision, or if the general mindset is against tough supervision but for light touch supervision. The extreme cases are the Baltic states where banks are Scandinavian. They behaved entirely rationally from their individual point of view, and they toppled the countries, all three of them, basically. Well, not with final success, unfortunately, but it's basically due to the strengths of those three societies. So the question that we are asking ourselves: will those banks be treated on a market-based way? Will they be treated fairly if the parents go under? Well, the next question. I could say, will the single supervisor and the single resolution authority be equally concerned with those branches, which happen to be systemically important for countries like Poland, but are completely unimportant for those huge banks? Pekao S.A., which is the second bank in Poland, accounts for 3.5% of the consolidated balance sheet of UniCredit, and it brings half of net profit. Thank you very much. So the next thing that we are concerned about, that we are asking ourselves, and I'm closing my statement, is the status of macroprudential policies. We think that, and the experience shows that imbalances do not only show up on a regional, on a global level, but also nationally or sub-regionally in two neighboring countries. But as we have recently realized in Europe, they show up in certain sectors, like in shipyard. Jean-Claude already left ESRB, but we recently had a problem whether we should not look at certain sectors, industrial sectors like shipbuilding industry, that pose a systemic problem for banking industry in certain countries. Well, if this is so, then you have to have macroprudential instruments being at hand of national authorities, who know better where those imbalances show up. And of course, we need pan-European coordination, ESRB. We need probably prioritization, because some of those are much less important than others, and we don't. We should choose which imbalances to tackle first. But we are bound to have spillovers from one country to another. Well, one most flagrant spillover that happened recently and was completely overlooked was a spillover from Greece to Cyprus. Well, so you have to, you have macroprudential instruments in national hands. And we know now that SSM will also be macroprudential body. This is very handy. And the Czech National Bank is a very good example that if you are a microprudential supervisor, so you control banks, let's say, you supervise and regular banks, then you basically don't really need a macroprudential body. Because you can use microprudential instruments for macroprudential purposes. Well, but it's not the case in Europe, because you have 28 now, as of next week or so, 28 members with 28 national authorities. So, the questions that we are asking about the future SSM is, what is going to be the status of macroprudential policies? What will be the link or the relation between SSM and ESRB? So these are basically the questions and many more that we are asking ourselves, not to be better prepared, so to say, to make a good decision. Thank you very much. I will stop short here. Yes.
Thank you very much, Marek. I think in a very informal way, especially in the second part of your presentation, you excellently described the pitfalls and also potential positives of banking union. And thank you very much for expressing the way which I wouldn't call from periphery, I would just call it a view from a group of countries who came through a certain type of a transition from a centrally planned economy to the present situation when the banking sector developed again in a certain way with a huge participation of the foreign banks, where the local banks are mostly subsidiaries in a different functional forms of the mother banks, which are basically rooted in Western Europe in today's Eurozone countries. Ladies and gentlemen, let me move to our third speaker, which is a domestic Czech speaker. I'm very glad that Zdeněk TŮMa accepted our invitation. Zdeněk studied at Prague School of Economics. Then he was my younger colleague in the Institute of Forecasting, Prognostický ústav, in the Academy of Sciences before 1989. After that, he started also his academic career. He was teaching and he's co-author of even a textbook on macroeconomics. Then he served as an advisor to Czech Minister of Industry and Trade, which happened to be myself. And then he left my advisory body to the private financial sector. Then, if I'm not mistaken, he served in a high-level position at EBRD. And in 1999, and correct me if I'm wrong, Zdeněk has been named the vice governor of the Czech National Bank, and in 2010 becoming the governor. He resigned in 2010, and for the moment he again works in the private sector as the advisor of KPMG in Czech Republic, and I believe also in Central Europe. Zdeněk, once again, thank you for accepting, and the floor is yours.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Vladimír, thank you very much for the invitation and for your kind introduction. It's a great pleasure for me and honor to be on the panel with my former colleague Jean-Claude and Marek. It's for the second time when Vladimír and the Prague 20 organizes a discussion on Euro. It was almost 4 years ago when we had Otmar Issing here in Prague. So when Vladimír turned to me and asked whether I would speak here, I was asking myself, well, what's new I can deliver regarding Euro? Obviously, it's not completely new issue. On the other hand, there are new challenges, and at least there are two important changes in the last 4 years. First of all, it's 4 years, so that we have new facts, new experience with Euro and Eurozone. And secondly, and more importantly, we have had the crisis, so it was the real first test of Euro under enormous pressure. So hopefully I would focus on some of challenges we face in the EU and Eurozone faces. So unlike last time when I posed the question, what's the primary role of Euro and of the monetary policy? And I said, well, the primary role of the monetary policy is to deliver price stability. So I was focusing on that aspect, but the domestic monetary policy in the Czech economy, whether it delivers the price stability, and I was comparing it with the Eurozone. So it was purely economic focus on that. My conclusion was that the Czech National Bank was delivering the price stability, so its role was stabilizing. Obviously, in case if a country doesn't have a stabilizing monetary policy, it's more advantageous to import it from outside, in other way, to fix the exchange rate or to adopt euro or something like that. So it was very, very much economist point of view. Today, I would like to speak about something slightly different, about the expectations and whether expectations are realistic or not. It seems to me that some unrealistic expectations at the launch of Euro led to some problems per se. So in other words, that it can be counterproductive. From this point of view, we can speak about some myth about Euro, because some people believe at the beginning that Euro can contribute to the real convergence, that it can increase the inter-regional trade, it can deliver price stability, and certainly in this respect, I would fully agree. So let me focus first of all on that aspect of the real convergence. When we look at the figures, can see that in the last 10-15 years, the Eurozone countries have been growing in general. But on the other hand, we can hardly find any convergence regarding economic growth among these countries. When we compare that growth with other developed countries like the OECD group, we wouldn't find significant differences. For me, this is not surprising. This is something what should be expected, because the choice of the about the monetary policy framework can hardly deliver higher economic growth. The monetary policy framework cannot influence the structural issues, cannot resolve structural problems of the economies. Obviously, you can make mistakes with the monetary policy, and then it can have an impact on the real variables. But otherwise, the choice of the monetary policy regime is much more about the volatility of inflation and the real variables rather than increasing the economic performance. So if some countries were growing faster, like it was the case of the Czech Republic, Slovakia, Poland, it was primarily due to other reasons, like some fundamental factors. And these countries were in the process of catching up. So this is what we call the real convergence. But they were catching up due to high competitiveness, skilled labor force, and still relatively cheap at that time, and other reasons. Obviously, this is the challenge for our countries for the future, whether there is still that potential to catch up at such pace as we were as we were catching up in the previous decade. I would be a bit skeptical about the Czech economy at this moment, but this is beyond the scope of today's remarks. Another extremely important aspect and expectations regarding foreign trade, or it's we should not call it foreign trade today, but let's call it intra-regional trade, because it means the trade within the eurozone. It was quite important argument, which was used also by the IMF, for instance, in their study many years ago, because it was one of points which made some sense. The argument was, well, euro can contribute to higher intra-regional trade, and because we know that there's a correlation between the foreign trade or intra-regional trade and economic growth, it could contribute to the economic growth. The problem is that we know that there's a correlation, but we are less sure about the causality, but the growth, the economic growth or the economic performance contributes to higher trade, or whether higher trade contributes to the economic performance. So it's certainly these variables are correlated. So what's how the facts look like? So that looking back in the last 10 years, we can see that there's a moderate growth both in euro area and EU as the whole, regarding when we, in terms of the share of trade to GDP. Nevertheless, that growth we can observe also in other regions. So it would be difficult to attribute it purely to the effect of euro, and that growth is not substantial. So that probably this was also another expectation which was not realistic. So that I don't think. Well, we will see. Still. We should take into account that these trends take time, and that thorough evaluation can come in the horizon of 10 or 20 years. Nevertheless, 10 years is already, 10 years plus is already a sufficient long period, and until now, in my opinion, we haven't found the evidence that increasing, a moderate increase in intra-regional trade would contribute to the economic growth. Then, once again, another remark to the convergence. Obviously, euro contributed to better transparency regarding prices across the eurozone. So it was believed, and there were some expectations, that this price transparency could lead to some convergence of relative price levels. In some sense, it has happened, but still the differences across price across countries in terms of price levels persist. And obviously, there are other factors at the national level, so that euro probably contributed in this respect, but can hardly overweigh those fundamental factors at the national level. Certainly. There were other factors when we take into account countries like Poland, the Czech Republic. So there were other factors contributing to the convergence, both in terms of the price level. So that looking at the real effective exchange rate, we can see that in these countries, which were catching up, the convergence was relatively fast. But the evidence within the group of the eurozone is much weaker. Speaking about the intra-regional trade, there is another important aspect and one of the most challenging in this moment and in the coming future, and these are internal imbalances. Looking at the position of the euro area as the whole, we can see that it's relatively balanced vis-a-vis the rest of the world. So there are moderate surpluses or deficits regarding the foreign trade as a percentage of GDP. But the problem is that significant imbalances persist inside, and this is one of problems which became much more visible during the crisis, despite the fact that it wasn't unknown before the crisis. What I mean that some countries, typically we speak about Germany, but it's not only Germany, some countries are systematically in surplus and some countries in deficit. So it means that or indicates that some country seems to be more competitive as compared to others, and it also implies that it must be financed somehow. So it leads to systematic transfers of savings from one part of Europe or from some countries to other countries. The adjustment can be quite abrupt, as we see in Greece and other countries in this area. And that's one of my messages today, that unrealistic expectations at the beginning of Euro might have contributed to this problem, because decision makers at the national level, and it was also mentioned by Jean-Claude TRICHET, underestimated the necessity of structural changes within the economy. And when they entered the Eurozone, they probably felt to be in the safe haven, and the pressure on policy changes inside was much lower. Unfortunately, also financial markets were under this illusion, and I can mention good example of the Czech Republic and Slovakia, because we were going together. And for instance, when we look when we illustrate this point in terms of interest rates at financial markets. So in the past, you know, these economies were interrelated. Obviously, there are some structural differences, but we are very, very close to each other. Typically, the Czech economy in the past, the Czech Republic, has slightly lower interest rates in financial markets than Slovakia. Then Slovakia announced joining the Eurozone. And immediately, interest rates started to go down, and in fact, they broke the level of the Czech economy. But it didn't happen anything with those economies. Fundamentally, those economies were almost the same. So it was some kind of the illusion, a relatively moderate one, because the differences between the Czech Republic and Slovakia were not dramatic. But those changes were much more dramatic in other countries, because before entering the Eurozone, countries like Greece, Portugal, they had significantly higher interest rates as compared to primarily German bonds. And after joining the Eurozone, they went down. The situation and the debt service was much easier as compared to the past, and the pressure on domestic austerities was much less. So somehow even experts in financial markets mix together, in my opinion, two points. One is the monetary policy, and the second is that there are some fundamental factors regarding the competitiveness, regarding the performance, regarding the fiscal sustainability. And this is not unrelated completely, nevertheless still relatively separated, so that the public finance sustainability was one of those areas which became quite acute during the crisis. And my last point regards that area of the price stability. So in this respect, Euro was certainly successful. In fact, it managed to maintain or to transfer that credibility of more credible countries to the region as the whole. On the other hand, we observed a similar development in other areas as well, so that the previous decade or previous 15 years was the period when central banks were quite successful around the world. So that the stabilization of inflation happened also in other countries, not only in Eurozone area. It was also the case of other EU countries, but also other countries around the world. So certainly in this respect, the ECB has been successful, but it's quite difficult to say that we can attribute it to euro only. So perhaps let me conclude that that there are, you know, it's clear from the very beginning that there are two important aspects of that process of economic integration of, let's say, euro. That euro has the economic and political aspect. Purely from the economic point of view, I believe that it's that the expectations and the hopes were higher at the beginning, and that we cannot expect too much. It's still a monetary policy framework. It's some kind of the fixed exchange rate, which can bring some advantages, but we can hardly expect improvements regarding the real performance of the economy or structural fundamental changes. On the contrary, unrealistic expectations could have contributed to some problems we observe today. And the second aspect is the political one. It's part of the political and economic integration of Europe. And in this respect, I believe that still the project would continue. But once again, it depends very much on the political will. So that from this point of view, a very important area, which is the fiscal policy and the fiscal sustainability, on the one hand, somehow related to the whole euro project, but it depends very much on the national political will. So that from this point of view, I'm a bit skeptical about supranational schemes. I don't think that that single fiscal policy would resolve the problem. Still, we need the discipline at the national level, and it will not change in the coming future. Thank you very much.
Well, in our original statement, we say that Prague 20 wants to be a place where people with different opinions gather and discuss the really pressing issue of today's, not only Czech Republic, but Europe. And that we would like to bring a first-class experts and speakers on the subject. And I believe that we succeeded today. I would like to thank very much to Jean-Claude TRICHET, because you came to Prague and you knew that it would be, if I'm not saying a hostile place, at least it would be a place where maybe no technical discussions about banking union, SSM and SRM and whatever, but rather kind of meditation might take place, and a discussion proved that your expectations were right. But nevertheless, you came. And not only myself, but we are all extremely happy and proud that you came. But the same applies to Marek. Marek BELKA is an acting governor. An acting governor has always kind of a responsibilities which makes him much more vulnerable to come and to speak freely on these subjects. And again, Marek, thank you very much. And last but not least, Zdeněk, you are always a good friend who supported us. Thank you very much for coming. Let me make the final announcement. Prague 20 would like to organize again with Aspen for still another conference in the fall of this year with this international participation. But we would like to inform you via our database and emails that we plan a kind of a change. We also would like to launch in the autumn our regional presence, and the first conference which we organize regional oriented will be on 24th of September in Ostrava. But apart of that, we will continue on organizing the events with this angle and with international participation. This panel comes to a conclusion. Thank you very much once again to the participants. Thank you for coming, for discussing, and for having a courage to withstand untypical tropical Prague weather. Thank you very much.